Hello and welcome to another FinStream. It is Monday, July 18th, 2016, and it's been a while since I've done a stream because I was out of town. I was out in the desert. I was out in Arizona. I was teaching a chess camp there in Tucson, Arizona for about a week. So fortunately, I was able to bring you guys some videos from that camp I was teaching at, plus some other stuff that I pre-recorded. But it's good to be back doing a stream. I hope I'm showing up, my audio and video. There's always this delay before that kicks in. Hello to Craig, Chun Min, Philosophical, Ari, Kazi, some what looks like Hebrew characters I can't pronounce, Nikmata, Toby, Craig, David, how's it going? Welcome everyone. It's about 6 o'clock p.m. U.S. Central Time. Catch any Pokemon lately? No. I have not downloaded Pokemon Go. I'm hoping not to get into that craze. I'm very selective about that sort of thing because I have an addictive personality, as many of you do as well, especially when it comes to games. So if I get into a game, I tend to go all in on the game. As happened with chess before, and chess is my main thing that I still do, so I have to be careful about which games I play. I don't want to get too wrapped up in it. Hey Jonathan, hey the Kai. Pedro, Vinif, Yo-Yo, Tony, Martin, Carrie, Jack in Your Box, Christoffo, PD Smooth, Richie, Ian. Love that you guys are showing up. Okay. Yeah, we're going to play some 3-minute chess today, Matze. And in fact, I'm going to get started right now. How's it going, Tripes Forever and Arab Assassin? And also Webley. I did play a little bit in the past week. I played in a Blitz tournament while I was down in Tucson. It was a pretty strong Blitz tournament because a bunch of the campers played and all of the instructors played. And some of the instructors included guys like Grandmasters Robert Hess, Alexander Ipatov, who's in the top 100, Julio Sedora, who ended up winning the tournament. And in the final two rounds of the tournament, it was 10 rounds, double rounds, so you play each person twice. I started off 6-0. I beat some campers in a few nice games, actually. And then I played Grandmaster Julio Sedora in round 4, and we split our games. It was 1-1. He beat me pretty handily in the first game. There was a move that I hesitated on for like a minute. I had a decent position as black in an exchange Slav, and I just hesitated inexplicably on this one move for an entire minute. I don't know what got into me. I do that sometimes. It frees up. So he beat me handily in that game. And then in the second game, I was white, and I flagged him in a really unclear position. The Scandi Swindler came out. I displayed my swindling powers out in the desert, and I flagged him in a position where he had this mating attack, but it was tricky. He had to figure it out, and he couldn't do it in time. So after that, I played Alexander Ipatov in the final round. There were several players who were on the score of, 7-1? And Ipatov was a half point behind, so he really wanted to beat me, ideally, in both the games. And I had a beautiful position in the first game. I was up 2 pawns, and I just blew it in time pressure. He's very resourceful. He got the better of me in mutual time pressure. So that was a huge bummer. But in the second game, I played well, and I won a rook end game, which was nice. So I finished with 8-2. Not bad. Won a little money. But most importantly, played some decent chess. Okay, so I'm going to play knight h6 here. This looks odd, but I'm hoping to use the f5 square at some point if these pawns get liquidated. So let's just castle here. What's up, the juice? How are you doing? And someone else says, greetings from China. Thank you for tuning in from China. Okay, I'm going to go here. So this is one of the common ideas in this line. You bring the knight back to f7. Possibly in preparation for an e5 pawn break. You do have to be careful about the d5 pawn. One thing that white can try to do in this line is they can try to get their c pawn up to c4. Right now it's blocked by the knight on c3, but I have seen examples where white will play like e takes d5, c takes d5, knight b5, with an eye towards playing c4. Immediately after that. Anton is here. Anton Ravenhood. We haven't seen the number one Team Scandi fan himself, Anton Squared Me, but Anton Ravenhood, I'm glad you're here. Okay, so Bishop g3, that's a prophylactic move probably against e5. I don't think I want to play e5. He's sort of challenging me to find a move right now, isn't he? Maybe Bishop g4, that move seems fine. He could play h3, but I'm thinking I might play Bishop h5, given that his bishop is on g3. It blocks his g-pawn. I suppose I could also trade on f3 and then maybe play e6, but that looks kind of passive. Yeah, he's just maintaining the tension here. Tricky, tricky guy. I think I'm going to go knight here and maybe bring the knight back to c7. Given that if I put the knight on d7, then I'm going to have issues with the d5 pawn. Now, I can't play this move, though, because he takes c7 and then takes d5. So maybe I should play e6, even though I'm not too keen to play that. Let's go rook e8, actually. We'll keep the tension for a moment. Yeah, he's just playing smart moves and centralizing his pieces. This orange juice. Okay, so e5 is played now. Take. There could be trades. I think I'm going to play knight c7. Maneuver for the e6 square. I no longer have to worry about d5, so that's nice. If he wants to take on f6, I'll take back with a pawn, most likely. Okay, so I'm going to take. I know I mentioned that I could play bishop h5 in response to this, but I'm liking this operation. And then I was thinking put the knight on e6, but I notice now he has bishop g4. So maybe bishop here first? Yeah, let's do this. This is going to look a little funky, but I think it'll pan out. Got to watch that time. We're both at a minute 30. That time can tick off your clock really fast. Okay, so now knight g5. How about that? Hit the bishop. Try to stick one of the knights on e6 next move. So if bishop g4, knight g to e6, I'm thinking. Yeah, let's do that. Got to get my rating back above 2400. Not happy about it being lower than that. I think I was up towards 2475 last time I streamed, and I just blew it. Hey, Shaunik. And Vinif. And Gwen, hello. Oh, is Rachel in the chat too? Rachel was a camper at the Western Invitational Camp, and she happened to receive one of the very first Team Scandi shirts. I made a limited print run of shirts with Team Scandi on them. Thanks to Tom, who's a channel viewer, he happened to be available to send me some, which was really, really nice of him. And I was able to hand them out to campers kind of as awards for doing well in the camp. And Rachel was the beneficiary of one of the Team Scandi shirts. And I have a picture of that, Rachel. I will post that on Twitter. Don't worry. As I promised you. Okay, how about a5 here? Let's just make an undermining move. He's really low on time. And now he knows it too. I'm going to take maybe something into f4. I'm thinking about going back to the square. Mostly I just want to play fast, but I'm thinking the trades are all right. This pawn on b4 will be under attack. Okay, so now what if I take with an eye towards queen d6? Okay, so they prevented that. Yeah, okay. They're going c4 next move. So I think I should play this. I wanted to play queen d6, but that wasn't happening. So let's do this, and then queen d6 next move, I think. I like the look of this. Okay, we'll take. They should probably play for checkmate, because I don't think they have enough time to do anything else. So I'm looking for rook h8. They're not getting mated with queen h2, because they always have this escape square, but my pieces are circling now. The sharks are circling. Let's do this, because if they push f5, I have queen takes g4. Very important. And that guards the g6 square as well. So that worked out well. Okay, and OJ resigns. So, what to think of this game? Out of the opening, we had this typical, what do you call this line? The name of it is escaping me right now. Gurgenidze. The Gurgenidze. We had a typical Gurgenidze maneuver where black plays knight h6 and then f6 and then brings the knight back to f7. I don't fully trust this setup, but in blitz it's okay. I've played this like once or twice over the board, but mainly in blitz, fast time controls. But it's kind of interesting. And black can angle for e5. I recall a game where I was able to do that. Most players, in my experience, either take on d5 or push e5 sooner than what this player did. Sometimes as early as move right here, move number 5. Right after black plays d5, they'll often make a decision. Hello, Jose. Not too much up with me. I've just been taking it easy the last couple days. When I got back from this camp, I slept for like 12 hours one day. My flight got in super early in the morning. I think it was 1:30 a.m. or something after traveling virtually half the day and waking up really early that day as well. And I just crashed for like 12 hours. I woke up, I felt great. So I've just been hanging out. Probably not, Shonik. I'm probably not going to play the Grob, but let's get back in there. Hey, John, what is your thoughts on tables? I'm playing on one right now. It's a desk. I don't have strong thoughts on tables one way or the other, though. Did you watch the U.S. Junior closed? Yeah, so I saw that Jeffrey Zhang clinched. And looks to me like he deserved it. He played well from start to finish. I think he lost one game, but he was clearly the best player in the field. He must have won by a clear point. Oleg IM. Don't know who this is, but I'm going to open with D4. It is not Olegas. I can tell you that. So let's see if we get a Grünfeld or a King's Indian. I'm going to play a Samish. Let's go F3, Knight GE2. I like this line. Okay, D5. Typical stuff. We'll play Knight G3. If A6, usually A4. Okay, against that one, I think I want to play Bishop G5. And then A4. If they play Queen B6, no, Queen C7 instead. Okay, so let's play Queen D2. And now I think Bishop H6, because I want to trade the dark square bishops if possible. Yeah, so let's do this. This is going to block my development for the time being, but I don't think it's that big of a deal. The only thing is, maybe I should have traded on G7 first. Because now this might confound my development slightly if black is able to take with the queen and influence this diagonal in the D4 square. That seems annoying. John, have you had a very bad tournament after a breakup? No, I can't claim that breaking up has affected my chess very much in the past. Okay, so now let's take here. Let's see which way they take. Because at least they move their queen, and if they want to recapture, they have to move the queen again. Okay, that makes me feel somewhat good. Okay, let's just go bishop e2. If they take on e4, I'm going to take with the knight and hit the d6 pawn. f4. All right, so black is playing for like a clamp, basically. Let's play knight d3 and attack this pawn. Now I'm considering castling long. Because black has a bunch of pieces masked on the king side. Yeah, so what if I play just g3 here and try to attack them? Yeah, let's do this first. So make a pawn break, attack h4, f4. See if we can blast open this position. Alex, I would not recommend messaging me on chess.com. I get so many messages there, it's ridiculous, and a lot of spam messages too. Best way to contact me, go to my about page on my YouTube channel and click on business email. That'll give you a direct link to my email. Okay, let's take this way. Hello, Jon from Iceland. Good to hear from you. Glad you could make a stream. What is your favorite Rush song? I would say Kid Gloves. Kid Gloves is a great song. I suggest you go listen to it right now. It's hard to single out one song because Rush is just an amazing band, but that song in particular I really like. Okay, so take on e5, nah, we're going here. So if they take d3, we can take either way. If knight c4, I think queen e1 should be fine. I'm not too worried about the knight on c4. I've got pressure down the g and the h files now. This is looking nice. Some threats brewing, like f4 perhaps, doubling on the g file maybe. Maybe a sacrifice on h7 someday. Yeah, and they're going to make it crazy because what else can they really do here? Take on h7, they'd have to take with a king, but I don't see that leading anywhere. Take here, queen takes, but then what? I can't go f4, so that's going to slow me down slightly. f4 now. Take. A little tough to say at this juncture. I'm just deciding between seemingly good options. Okay, I'm going to play f4. I know they can play knight c4 with tempo, but I still like the look of this move. Wow, they took instead. Ah, they can do that. But all right, this could get interesting. Rook takes f4. e5, maybe. Surprised they took on d3. So e5, yeah, let's go e5. I think they have to play bishop f5 against that. Otherwise, their position is losing. But then I can win a piece. So bishop f5, queen takes f4, g takes f4, rook takes g7, king takes g7, bishop takes f5 at the very end. Yeah, so they didn't even do that. Rook takes g5, not quite working. I think I'm just going to cut off their pieces with this move, looking for knight e4 next. I mean, this pawn on e6 is so strong, it almost obligates them to sacrifice a piece. Yeah, this should just be really, really bad for black. Too many threats coming. Knight e4 next. They can play c3 and try to distract me for another move, but rook takes g5 is a threat. Knight takes g5. Knight takes d6. I think just take here is easiest. Yeah, let's do that. Open up the attack on the rook. Yeah, black can always throw in c3, but it doesn't do much. Let's go here. Rook e5, I'm going to play queen f4. My king is safe enough. Queen f7 could be good. Just bishop takes g6 as well should be crushing. Yeah, let's do that. And then I think knight f3 or knight f7. Just making sure I don't get mated somehow. Yeah, this is going to work. No issues. Mate in a couple. That's a nifty mate, actually. D6 checkmate. Okay, so we win against Oleg IM. Vinif, are you causing problems? Please be civil in the chat. Looks like Anton is not here. This is a really unusual occurrence that one of my only mods is not present. There are only two people that are mods on this channel. Actually, three, if you count me. Thank you, Arab Assassin. That's not going to happen, but thank you very much. Ah, Anton is here. Okay. Miguel says, hi from CT. Can you show us your immortal if you have one? I don't have an immortal, Miguel. I played some nice games, but not one that would qualify as an immortal. Hello, Semi from Germany. Hello, Maimon and Anatole. All right, let's get back in there. We're on a 2-0 streak to start. How many viewers do we have right now? 243. Awesome. Love it, guys. Thank you for being patient for another stream while I was out of town. It's summer, though, so I notice a lot of people are traveling, especially chess players. Tons of tournaments are happening in the summer. People just go on vacation. As far as my plans for the next month or so, I'm playing a tournament up in northern Minnesota at the beginning of August, the Twin Ports Open. It's in Duluth, Minnesota. It's a great tournament if you guys are in the area, if you're from Wisconsin or anywhere and just want to make the trip. You can fly into Minneapolis-St. Paul, take like an hour and a half drive up north, and you'll be in beautiful Duluth, Minnesota, right on Lake Superior. So I'm playing that. I'm also giving a lecture there. And then I'll be out in North Carolina in mid-August for a week, teaching at a camp run by one of my friends, which is always a good time. Beyond that, though, I don't have too many plans. Okay, Zongguo is the next opponent. What to play here? Let's play e4. Move one. Try to pick up where I left off in previous streams, trying out e4 more often. Okay, I'm going to play f4. Bishop g7, I'm going to play kind of a funky move, a3. I picked this idea up in a SOS column in New in Chess a long time ago. Can they play that move? Okay, I'm going to take. So the idea of a3 is if they go queen a5, you can play b4. It's kind of weird, but that's the plan. Okay, so let's go here. Probably they'll play b6 to defend. And let's just play bishop c4. My g4 square is a little tender. I have to make a note of that. But Okay, here I'm thinking of castling, but knight g4 is a concern. e4 is not a problem, because if they take, I do have bishop takes f7. Yeah, let's just castle. If knight g4, I think bishop back to c1 is okay. Even bishop d2 is fine there. Unless they could take on c3 and then take e4, but that still runs into bishop takes f7. So if they grab the e4 pawn, you'll see what I mean, but I suspect they see this tactic and probably won't go for it. But for example, if knight takes e4, yeah, they're going to do that. So let's go here. I was thinking they might be able to take c3 and then grab e4, but I don't think that works out for them. H3, yeah, h3 should be okay. Kick that knight back. They want to get their knight into d4. I think that's the plan. If knight f6, can I play e5? e5, knight h5. Something along those lines. Wow, rook takes d2. Didn't even look at that move. I think I see their plan, though, but I'm still going to play this. They're going to check on d4, and then knight e3, or maybe knight f2. But knight f2 is not good. I can play king h2, so probably knight e3. They do play knight f2, though. That's odd. Thought they were going to go knight e3, but my bishop on c4 is defended by my knight, so maybe this combination just doesn't work for black at all. Uh-oh, I see someone got banned in the chat. Or put in a timeout. Okay, rook d8. So I want to attack this bishop. Now they're threatening to take and then take on e4. So I'd like to play some sort of solidifying move, but what could that be? Maybe e5? Nah, but take. Yeah, that's the big threat. Take, take, and then win the knight on d2, so I must be mindful of that. Okay, let's play this instead. And I'm anticipating bishop takes c3. Okay, I think I know what I'm going to do. So after knight takes e4, I'm going to play knight g5. Unless some other move catches my eye, but knight g5 looks all right. If knight takes knight, then pawn takes and I'm on f7. And maybe I'll have time to play rook d1. I'd like to avoid losing two pawns. Black won one pawn back. My structure is kind of crippled. But if I could avoid losing two pawns, that would be nice. This is a good move. Again, a move I didn't see. Now I don't like my position. That was a strong move they just played. Okay. I'm going to try this. And if rook d2, I guess bishop f1. But I'm not happy about it. Rook takes c2, rook e1, then they have knight f3 check. I'll probably have to escape the pin on the second rank somehow. They're going to go knight f3 right away, okay. They want to take g5. Bishop d3 now, maybe? But then rook takes g2. That's pretty final. Rook e1, yeah, let's go rook e1. All of a sudden, I have to be really cautious. If e6, I do have h4, though, don't I? That is nice. Okay, so let's offer a trade. If they move the rook back, maybe bishop c4. This game is still up in the air. I'm not out of it yet. Yeah, let's do this. Knight g5, h4, no. Let's do this. I want to try to get them to play e6 so I can hit them with that h4 move. Completely missed knight e5 on move 20. This guy sees the tactics, though. I think he senses that e6 is going to run into this, but he doesn't have a lot of time. That's his issue right now. Okay, now we're going to do this. We're going to win a little material back. Now I'm going to take here. Not really concerned about getting mated or something. I mean, king h3 was probably also good there, but this should be fine. Okay, let's play the king over to h3 now. So now he's got to be really careful where he puts his bishop, right? There's just all sorts of checkmating nets and such. He doesn't have hardly any time either. Okay, so we prevailed in the complications right there, but that was touch and go. Definitely after knight e5 on move 20, I was not feeling my position. And as I said, I didn't even look at rook takes d2. I probably should have, but it escaped my attention. h3, rook takes d2, followed by bishop d4. Originally, I thought their idea was knight to e3, attacking the rook and the bishop, but the bishop is defended by the knight on d2, so let me just put on the engine real quick. Again, I don't advocate using the engine as a replacement for thinking about the position, but in a 3-minute game, when you guys are just thirsting for the next game, I think it's fine. Yeah, knight e3 is still decent here, because knight e3 is going to mess with my coordination. It attacks c2. Black is very active, but I suspect knight f2 is a mistake. Right there. Although even here, it's not cut and dry. White has an advantage, but it's not a gigantic advantage. What should I have played right here? Knight d5, leaving the b2 pawn attacked, but their bishop is somewhat overloaded. Knight d5 would have just e6, then c3. Knight d5, e6, c3, the engine wants to play. That's already pretty complex. 3-0. That's right. Thanks, the Kai. John, do you prefer e4 or d4 openings? I mostly in tournaments play d4 or knight f3 on move 1 these days, but I also have been known to play the English c4 on move 1, and I'm trying to play more e4. Not so much in tournaments, but trying to. John, how do I become a mod? There is no formal application process. I just have to look at you and deem you worthy someday. Can we get a Vienna Gambit? Not an opening I have any experience with, but maybe. All right, another game, let's do this. Already I've won way more games than I did on my last stream, I think. I believe in my last stream, I won 1 game out of 10. It was something really bad, like 1 win, 4 losses, 4 draws. So we're already well ahead of that today, guys. Hello, Darnaby. Glad you could catch the stream as well. John, have you ever played GM Eric Hansen? Yes, I have. Twice in tournament games. I think twice. I believe we drew on both occasions. These games were quite a while, though. Quite a while ago, though. And we've played several times online in Blitz and Bullet. And I think with our online results, Eric definitely has the advantage. Portuguese Gambit. That would be interesting, Fabrice. I will try to play that. John, do you think joining a chess club is a good idea for a beginner? Absolutely. Absolutely, Ben. Don't wait. If you have a good club in your area, just join right now. Don't hesitate. I think people wait too long to get into over-the-board tournament chess. They tell themselves that they want to get good just playing online and studying, but if you have a good club in your area, jump right in. Any advice for getting out of a slump? Increase the time control in the games that you're playing and play less games in general. Do more analysis. So take the games that you have played and rigorously analyze them. Try to get to the source of the problem or problems, because there's probably more than one. But that's what I do when I'm going through a rough stretch. I don't decrease the time control and play more games. That's really bad. You can just go on tilt that way. So try to play less. Study some chess if that takes your mind off of your results. And you'll be back in there. Hey, Rusit Gold. Thanks for joining in. Glad you like those tactics videos. Okay, let's see if we can get a Portuguese Gambit. So it starts with knight f6 on move 2. But he plays knight c3. Yeah, the Portuguese Gambit would be if d4, bishop g4. So this line I'm a little less familiar with. I'm going to go knight b6. And a bishop b3, I'm going to play c5. I used to dabble in this system when I played knight f6 on move 2 back in the day. It's not that great, but in Blitz it's fine. Okay, so let's just castle. and then put the knight on c6. I do think there are some advantages to having the pawn on c5, especially when the white has the pawn on d3. You have good control over this square. The only thing is, I wish I could play b6 and bishop b7. So let's bring the knight into d4. Maybe a trade will happen. Okay, knight d5, I was thinking now. I can tell that my voice isn't 100%. Maybe because I haven't recorded a video in like a week. It's a little weaker than it usually is. I don't know if I'm really scared of a5. I'm going to let him play that move if he wants. I'll just play b5 and close it up. If a6, bishop c6, I think it's just as likely that this pawn will become a weakness than a strength. So what do I want to do next? Probably rook c8. Maybe attack c2 in the long run. I do have this half-open file that I can use to attack it. Does that move do anything? I guess knight g5 is their plan. Again, I'm not that concerned, though. Let's just do this. They can't lift a rook to like the third rank easily and swing it over to g3. If knight g5, I think just knight f6 is what I'm going to do. Okay, so now this move. And if queen h4, maybe h6. I am inviting a sacrifice on e6. Okay, maybe I should play this move. Just to kill some of white's play against the e6 pawn. There are four pieces converging on that square. So if I can get another defender and block the bishop on b3, that's probably good. Now if the bishops get traded, let's say bishop takes d5, queen takes d5, the c2 pawn is under attack. So I like this move, bishop d5. I'm not playing h6 yet. I don't want to weaken my king side, but I may have to play that soon. We'll see. He might be contemplating some crazy stuff like rook takes e6 or something, but I don't think it's working. This is what often happens to me, what's happening to my opponent right now. He's thinking for a while, trying to find like a forcing line when one may not exist. Okay, how about now h6 or take on c3? Actually take on c3, definitely, because, yeah, he couldn't take with the bishop due to the knight hanging. So rook d8 or h6. Let's go h6 first of all. And I'm thinking rook d8 after that. Yeah, so bring this over, hit the d3 pawn. See if he takes. There's always the possibility of bishop takes h6, but I don't really believe it. I may be courting disaster with that statement, but I just don't think that move works for him. Okay, now b4 looks thematic. Undermining move. If take, I'm going to take with the bishop, I think. f2 is a little tender for him. Maybe queen a2. This looks pretty good. This way I stay guarding e6. Now if this bishop moves, my queen will be attacking f2 as well. So I'm going on the counterattack, guys. Rook c2 could be in play. I do have to watch bishop e3. I could always go scoop up the a6 pawn as well. He wants to sacrifice, or at least I would if I were white, but that doesn't appear to work. Bishop c3, maybe? Let's do that. He's in pre-move mode already. Okay, let's take here. Go take that. All right, so we secured an extra pawn. This is nice. Let's just bring this guy all the way back and then offer a trade of queens. Should be a pretty smooth cleanup job with the time. Just prevent any back rank business. I mean, I'm sure some of the moves I'm going to play here are not the best, but he has literally no time. Okay, and we win. I think we managed to develop in an orderly fashion. The one thing that was bothering me is the fact that I couldn't get my light square bishop into the game so easily with the position here with the knight on b6. I'd love to play pawn b6 and then bishop b7, but my opponent was not allowing that. So that's why I jumped into d4 and then played knight d5. And with queen h5, white was looking to attack. I think this is instructive right here because in that position, there is a temptation to play pawn to g6. So going back here for a moment, queen h5, you might think, oh, I got to get that queen out of my grill. I got to play pawn to g6 to attack it. But if you do that, you have pawns committed to light squares, and this creates dark square weaknesses around my king, namely h6 and f6. So I don't think this is really necessary. Then white might be looking to play knight g5, and they're in even closer to my king. So resist that urge to play a pawn move around your king when you don't necessarily have to. Again, g6 might be fine, but I think the position otherwise is completely acceptable. Yeah, I just played a calm move like rook c8, knight g5. You can see the engine eval right here. Knight f6, hit the queen and defend h7. And now this bishop d5 move, defending e6. And I probably would rather be black. I think this assessment is correct because I don't see white breaking through against my king. And white does have a certain weakness on the c-file, on the c2 pawn. John, that king behind you needs a queen. Yeah, it could. It's a good point. Which can help you more, playing or training? I think overall, playing definitely helps you more. The rule is, the lower rated you are, the more you need to play and just build your practical experience. The higher rated you are, the less you need to play, the more you need to study, in my opinion. Topic for Chess Castle lecture next week. So the Chess Castle is this club, my local club here in Minneapolis, where I've played pretty much all my life. And I've been giving some lectures there recently. The topic I think will be on Minnesota players past and present. So I want to go over guys like Kurt Brasket, who was a many-time Minnesota state champion and passed away a couple years ago. Sean Nagel, who's our current Minnesota state champion, also an IM like me. Maybe Andrew Tang, who's in high school and he's an international master, a student of mine. So I'm going to go over some of their names. X-Storm is asking for a Banco Gambit. We shall see, X-Storm. I recall you mentioned you played Counter-Strike back in the day. You should stream a session sometime. Maybe. That's an interesting idea. I probably wouldn't do it on my main channel here, but if I fire up my Twitch channel, maybe I would. Good question. What counts as higher rated? So when I was answering that question about playing versus studying, I would say above 2,000, you might get more benefits actually putting study time into the game. Certainly at my level, I don't get better just playing a lot online. I need to supplement that with a lot of study. And since the majority of my chess time is just spent playing these days and playing on the channel, aside from teaching, I would say that I'm not studying in the best way possible at the moment. But then again, I'm not seriously pursuing my Grandmaster title or anything at present. Anton, you got to make a lecture sometime. Hello, Nicholas. Okay, let's get back in there. Someone asked about the Kali Zukertort opening. They said, I'm considering to play it as it avoids my opponent's preparation. It's not bad. I've played it a few times. In fact, I played it in a couple tournament games back in December, January. It's a decent weapon. I wouldn't overdo it, though. I wouldn't make it my main weapon, personally. It's too formulaic. The Oracle. What was your experience like playing poker? So I got into poker when Chris Moneymaker won the World Series of Poker back in, whatever it was, 2003, 2004. And I played online for a solid, like, 6 years after that. 6-7 years. Up until Black Friday. And I mostly played micro stakes. I multi-tabled like 25 cent, 50 cent. And I didn't make any crazy amount of money, but I made a little bit of money. It's really addictive, poker, online poker. I'm glad I don't really play it anymore, because looking back on it, it was kind of a waste of time. The thing I don't like about poker is that if you remove the money element of it, so if you're not playing for cold hard cash, the game ceases to become interesting, at least for me. And I think that's a good way to judge a game. Like, can you just play it purely out of passion, like when there's nothing at stake? And with chess, I've never felt that way. There doesn't have to be anything at stake for me to enjoy a chess game. John, please address the King's Gambit accepted request. I put the correct pronunciation, punctuation. So you want me to play the King's Gambit? Or you want me to take the pawn if someone plays the King's Gambit against me? Oh, hey, Chris. Chris Hagen, how's it going? Been a while since I've talked to you. He asked, do you have any specific long-term or short-term goals for your chess career? Short-term, I want to keep doing the channel, make good videos for you guys, and I'm also working a lot on Chessable, and I will be working more on Chessable in the next couple months. So I'm going to be investing a lot of time and effort into that. And that goes long-term as well. I really want to make Chessable as good a site as possible with my co-founder, David. We've got some plans in the works. And long-term, I would like to make Grandmaster, but I'm not putting a set timeline on that because there's just so many variables. And I can tell you right now, I'm not actively working towards it, as I've already said this stream. So that's about the only long-term goal that I have. Also, I want to continue doing my teaching. I've been a chess teacher for quite a while, and I want to keep doing a good job with that, too. I've been doing full-time chess teaching for about 5 years, and actually, lately, I've been teaching a little bit less to free up more time for stuff like Chessable, especially Chessable. But that's always on my list of goals, continuing to provide a good service for my students and help them grow. So this is another F3 Samish, or Knight GE2 Samish, I should say. This line where Black plays E5 against this leads to kind of a comfortable endgame for White. I know some of you guys are cringing that I'm playing an endgame, but trust me, this endgame is kind of pleasant for White, honestly. I've had this position a few times. Usually Black plays Rook D6. Note if Rook E8, then Knight C7 forks the Rook. So Rook D6, I think I play Rook C1 followed by Bishop C4. That's how I've usually treated this. Plays Rook F8. It's a little weird. Okay. I'm going to play Rook C1 anyways. Sometimes Black has an issue developing this light square bishop. Like a Bishop E6 now, Knight C7 is going to fork those two pieces. That's why I think the Rook would have been better on D6, because it helps to defend that bishop. Yeah, so now I get to play this. I think I've had this exact position too, honestly. So now let's take here. And then probably Bishop C4, hit the pawn. They're going to put their knight in on D4, but the structural damage is not insignificant. I think I should pull my bishop back to E3, but first let's play King to F2 just to connect the rooks. Okay, now they can try to double up their rooks on the c-file. That's probably the next step for them. So maybe Bishop D3. This move looks a little weird, but I don't want Black playing Rook C6 or Rook C7 and then Rook over to C8, Rook F to C8. So I'm going to try to disrupt that plan. They might put a Rook on D8. They're going to do this. H4 I'm considering. Yeah, I like the look of this move. Let's do that. If G takes H4, okay, they're going to play that way. So now there's some ideas of taking and then taking D4 and playing E5, but I don't see that panning out. What to do? H5 check always possible. Yeah, maybe H5 check. I feel like I have some good way forward here, but just taking a moment to reflect. Okay, let's do that check. I also would like to double up my rooks. Let's do this. So they can take and mess up my pawns, but at least then I control the d4 square and I'm going to boot back that knight. Probably they should take, because otherwise Rook c1 is coming and they're going to have to surrender the c-file, as far as I can tell. They do take. Okay, so let's bring the king over slightly. Not sure who got the better of that transaction. Again, I control d4, but I had to give up something for it. Okay, let's do this. They're angling for knight a5. They do want knight a5. Okay, now I'm going to go here. If knight a5, I'm going to play bishop d2, I think. I could also play c4. c4 is probably not bad. I'm going to go here. Maybe try for bishop g3. Bishop b5 could be played next to attack the knight. Let's go here. Tough to say what's happening right now. All I know is we're both really low on time. Maybe black has a solid position, I don't know. I think I'd like to play rook d7 soon. Yeah, let's take this opportunity now. I'm going to trade the rooks. Then maybe I can get my king up. They're just tied down to these pawns, basically. It's one big issue for them. Let's do this. And then we're going to go here. Ooh, and they drop this pawn. Now this is going to be really difficult because their knight is stuck. I'm going to do this. This is a little weird, but... Okay, I definitely didn't have to play c5, but again, no time for my opponent. Let's go back and take a look at that opening, because this is instructive in this line. One of the reasons I like knight g2 is specifically because of this line. So in the same-ish, the main move is bishop e3. But knight g2 has some points. Like, you keep the bishop flexible, you can bring it to e3, but you can also bring it to g5. And if they play e5, I think this is a good version of, like, an exchange variation for white. I'd played this over the board, and I have a good record with it. So you trade the queens, and then you sink the knight into d5, attacking c7, threatening bishop g5 as well. And after the trade, black virtually is forced to contest the pawn on d5. They don't want that pawn to sit there. And then you bring the other knight behind. This is slightly annoying. I mean, black may equalize from here, but I think they have to play 10 or 15 accurate moves to do so. So take knight c6, bishop g5. And as I mentioned, rook d6 is the move I see most often here. I'm just going to put on the engine because I am curious where I could have improved. Rook c1, bishop here, knight c7, forking the rook and the bishop. So the engine has given me a solid half-pawn advantage. Given that my bishop was a problem on the c-file, maybe I should follow the engine recommendation and just play king f2 right away. I bet it's going to say play the bishop to d3. Yeah. So put the bishop on d3. In doing so, I could have saved a move, right? Because I ended up playing this move anyways out of fear of, like, rook c6, rook c8. Black does have some compensation, though, for, like, the bad pawns and the lack of a bishop pair. Their knight on d4 is really strong. I want to see if this rook c3 idea was decent. Maybe I could have played it right here. Rook c3 right now. Get ready to double. Under the cover of the bishop. That's a nice theme. I think I played bishop d3 instead. Yeah, so I played bishop d3, h6, bishop back here. And then I played this undermining move, h4, but black seemed to react correctly, unless I missed something. The evaluation just jumped up right there. So what does the engine want to do? Take, take, king g3, and just waltz up to g4. This idea crossed my mind, but not in this exact position. Yeah, looking at it now, king g4 is always bothersome, especially in an endgame. If the rooks get traded or something? That's annoying. You can imagine if king g4, black responded with bishop f6, trying to defend the pawn twice, then I could play bishop takes d4, pawn takes d4, e5. So just to show that, let's just say black plays some random move, and this occurs, then this. And if they recapture, check. Discovery, win the bishop. I was pondering what to do here, whether to take or push. I just didn't see a clear way to follow up the attack on g5, but... I should have captured. That does create another weakness in black's position, another isolated pawn. I agree with that. Everyone comes here for my boyish good looks, not the actual chess. I don't want to reveal how many chess groupies I have, but there is more than one, I'll tell you that. John, what does average centipawn loss mean? So average centipawn loss is the thing I first saw in Lee Chess, and I think it means the deviation from the computer recommended line. So if you're playing a game, how often on average your moves deviate from what the computer likes. And the lower the average centipawn loss, the better. And Lee Chess categorizes your errors in terms of inaccuracies, mistakes, and blunders. And often people will refer to a 0-0-0 game, meaning that there are zero inaccuracies, zero mistakes, zero blunders, which normally results in a very low average centipawn. Anything below, I'd say 20 is pretty good. But I've had games where I get down to like 4 or 5 average centipawn loss, or 3 or something. And you see that in GM practice too. And lower than that too. I mean, just because you might be a little lower rated than I am GM, that doesn't mean you can't play a game with a low average centipawn loss. Someone asked about studying tactics. Well, I think the tactics trainers online are pretty good. Also, a book I've recommended is Tune Your Chess Tactics Antenna, as well as Imagination in Chess, if you're higher rated. I think Imagination in Chess is a really good puzzle book for players who are, let's say, 1800 plus. There's some really tough examples in there, but highly beneficial to your overall progress. The Kai, probably not much longer. I'm going to wrap this stream up soon, but I'll play maybe one or two more games. John, will you play any more Chess 960? I will try. Chess 960 always slips my mind, but I will try because I've had some people request that. Yes, and as John O'Dowd said, a centipawn is 1/100th of a pawn. That's a better way of putting it. The summation of your errors divided by the number of moves you made, says Chris Hagen. A metric of accuracy. I agree, Brian. The Lee Chess interface is nice. I like Lee Chess as well. I just tend to do my streams on ICC. Okay, let's play another one. Svesh Nemer, 2083. We're playing a lot of lower rated players. I'm still looking for a Portuguese gambit. So if they play d4, I'm going to play bishop g4. All right. Fingers crossed, guys. Let's hope they go f3. Ah, they played the buzzkill move. Again. They're always killing our enjoyment of this line. Okay, I'm going to play e6. Let's keep our queen active. We'll keep it on f5. Then I'm just going to look to castle soon. So at least our queen is not on d8 as it might often be. So that is a silver lining right here. Can I play knight c6? Or should I go knight bd7? Knight bd7 seems a little more coherent, but I kind of like knight c6. I'm going to do it. I was just checking to make sure d5 didn't hurt me or something. h6 maybe. Let's play rook fe8. Maybe rook fd8 is better. So many choices. Yeah, let's go rook fd8. I'm still hoping d5 doesn't work, but he played it instantly. Does that work? Take, take, knight takes, though. What are you up to against that, dude? I don't think this works for him. He seems pretty confident about it, though. So I'm attacking d5 three times. Yeah, so knight takes d5. If he takes on e7, I can take with my d knight. If knight takes d5, knight takes d5. Maybe he'll play knight takes d5, rook takes d5. But still, he winds up getting pinned at the end. I'm going to risk this. I can think about it a little bit more, but I'm going to risk it. Okay, against that one, here I can play bishop takes g5 if I want. But there's also rook takes d5. Bishop takes g5 might just be safer. Yeah, let's do this one. Okay, so I want to trap this knight. a6, just take away a flight square on b5. How about that? He's got some difficulties getting that piece free. I'm burning it some time, though. He's up a minute on the clock. But maybe it was worth it to attempt to trap this piece. We'll definitely go back and take a look at that. Okay, how do I win you? How do I win you? Queen a5. What's up with queen a5? This must be the way. Oh, rook takes d8, he can play. And I have to take with a knight. And his knight is still kind of trapped, but that's a bummer that I have to take with a knight. I was thinking I could play rook takes, but he does have queen e8, and I would have got mated if I had done that. So probably queen c4 now. Ah, but that loses the rook on e1. So his queen is overloaded, isn't it? Now he's trying to escape through d6, so this is really interesting. So we should cut that off. Let's play this move. Rook d1 now, though, is good, I think. Or at least sufficient. Knight c6, perhaps? Yeah, let's do this. Maybe I can just go win the b2 pawn. I might have to settle for that. Really gotta watch that time, too. Queen there. Okay, let's take this. He's threatening mate, so we gotta defend. He's threatening queen g7 mate. Gotta play fast. Gotta ramp up the speed here. Let's go h6. Queen back to g3, yep. I'm gonna play king here. Maybe with rook g8 on the horizon. He's probably gonna repeat. Fast player, this guy. Let's go knight e5. Trying to hit this h4 pawn. Okay, I'm going to take that. He could play h5 if he wants. I'm going to have to play knight h8 then. Ugh, this is kind of disgusting, isn't it? We can check on f6 if he wants, but that might not work. Queen there. Okay, let's do this. Hit the rook. Oh, I have 16 seconds left. Oh my gosh. I'm going to go over and win this pawn next, I hope. This is going to be a time scramble. I'm just hovering over that pawn. Make a move, fast. Brings the knight back to e8. That's funny. Time scramble. Knight e5 next, maybe? 7 seconds left. Want to push that pawn. I'm going to risk it with the pre-move. Let's go back here, take that. F4 coming. Ah, I lost on time. Yeah, I couldn't quite move there fast enough at the end. There goes my streak. Yeah, I played too slow in the middle game. These are the situations that can happen in 3 minutes. I just suspected there must have been a tactical way to punish him, but I couldn't figure out what it was. His knight always slipped out, just barely. Because right here, I'm controlling e6, I'm controlling d5, I'm controlling b5, so his knight doesn't have anywhere to go. I thought queen a5 was going to do the trick, but I missed that after rook takes d8, I can't take with a rook due to queen e8 with incoming mate. So I took with the knight. And his knight just experienced problems, and amusingly, he brought it back to e8 later on. He was purely playing on the clock, which makes a lot of sense. I would do the same if I were him. Yeah, just didn't quite have enough in the tank there. John, do you like Nigel Short? I don't have really strong opinions about him one way or the other. What is your biggest weakness? Against which openings do you struggle the most? Ooh, I'm not going to give away that sort of information, Alex. As far as my weakness, though, I think I sometimes shy away from messy positions. I often prefer clarity in my thought process, and I go for positions that are clear to me. So one thing I'm trying to do is embrace craziness and complications and messiness a little bit more. It's not really my style, but I think I have to work on that. Hello, Leonardo. What do you think about the book Mastering Chess Middle Games by Ponchenko? Really good book. I like that book a lot. For intermediate to higher rated players, that's a great middle game book. For players a little bit lower, I would recommend Mastering Chess Strategy by Johan Helston. It's a terrific middle game book too. David, I think that's too specific of a question at your rating level. I can't really answer with a general response. How to get better if you're 2100 trying to go to 2200. Most likely you just need to strengthen almost every facet of your game, but there could be some specific things. I'm sure there are some specific things that would not be covered in a blanket response. Do you enjoy playing nonsensical openings from time to time? You never play Roy Lopez or French much. Well, I don't play e4 too often, Anuj. And I don't play the French defense, you're right. Is Greg Shahadi's style the opposite of yours? I wouldn't say it's the opposite, but he tends to go for sharper positions. What rating would you consider good at chess? Totally subjective, Leonardo. That is subjective on who you'd ask. Since you asked me, I would say that 2200 is good at chess. A rating I'm impressed by is 2500 feet A or above. I would say then it starts to get impressive. 2600 feet A plus is extremely impressive. Okay, I'm going to play one more game, guys. I took a rating tumble because of this game against Svesh Nemer. But I'll try to come back in this one and answer some questions too before I wrap this up. When should you castle queenside? Asked Dehan. Position dependent. It totally depends. Oftentimes you're castling queenside because either your king will be safer over there or you're trying to launch an attack on the king side. You're trying to attack your opponent there. So you can see, for instance, in that game I played against Oleg IM. Let me pull up my history. I castled queenside in this game right at this moment because before that I had played g3, attacking his pawns on f4, h4, trying to blast open lines. I could have castled short here, but given how extended his pawns are, f4, g5, h4, I thought I could castle queenside. My king seems pretty safe over here. Black doesn't have any queenside pieces developed, and I already have the makings of a strong kingside attack. So that's a good example, good answer to your question. Okay, Rafa Nadal. Let's play knight f3 against him. I'm going to play my blitz opening. The Georg Meyer special, if Tony Rotella is still here. He'll know what I'm talking about. The German Grandmaster Georg Meyer often plays this way as white. He's very successful at it. Okay, we're going to go c4, knight bd2, queen c2, and probably e4. Let's do this. King h8 is pretty weird looking. Not sure why he played that move. Rook fe1 looks all right. We'll do it. Take. King h8 looks like a mouse slip. I can't think of any reason to play that move. All right, so we have a nice setup. I don't mind this position. Maybe h3. Yeah, let's just keep a piece out of g4, just in case he wants to play bishop g4, try to goad me into playing f3. I can try to play f4. Yeah, I think this is okay. Let's do it. Maybe tuck the king away somewhere. King h1. Let's do king h1. Bishop c3, queen b2 is another idea I have in the present position. He's playing pretty quick, so I'm going to try to match him on the clock. h5, okay. Stopping me from playing g4, but that does weaken g6 to some degree. So I could play f5 now, or at least think about it. I think I'm going to play this knight away. And maybe try to get into the g5 square. I've got e4 sufficiently defended, don't I? So this could be possible. Yeah, let's do this. Who is Rafa Nadal? The chess player, not the tennis player. Does this hang anything? Nah, I think it's fine. Let's pre-move that. Take. Brings his queen over. He's playing safe and solid chess. Okay. Can I win a pawn? I think so. Take check and then win a5. There is some question about e4, however. I wonder about e4. So if he plays king g8, queen takes a5, f6. He's going to play f6 right here. Okay. That makes sense. And if back, just knight takes e4. Maybe he's the one who's going to win a pawn now. That's funny. e5? Is e5 too crazy? e5, pawn takes. I'm going to try it. Got to try something with my time. He can just take on g5. Well, that was really dumb of me. Yeah, this is not good, what I just did here. You can just take with a rook now. This is completely bad. Alright, I'm going to try this. I think he can take g5, rook takes, and then play knight e6. I do get some pawns for it, but that did not go the way I would have liked it to. Ooh, that's a good move too. This is going to get nasty in a second. Yeah, he can just take. I got to take here. So now I only have, what? Two pawn, no, one pawn for the piece. What? Queen c7. What was that? Is this guy feeling generous today? Queen c7? Maybe he meant to play queen c5. What a weird game. He played king h8 out of the opening, a pointless move. Then outplayed me. I went on a foolhardy tactical operation. And then he offered me his queen for free. I don't know what to think about that. Well, this went from looking pretty good to just downright losing for me quite quickly. So e5 was just forcing it. I actually missed that he could play f6 here. I thought he had to play king g8 and then f6. But maybe after he played f6, as in the game, my position is just not very good. Because if I move the knight away, he can play knight takes e4. But the engine thinks king h2 is perhaps acceptable. And what if king g8 then? Let me take a look at that. So if f6, so what I mean is if here knight takes e4, and I only have the rook attacking the knight because my bishop is suddenly blocked. We are in something of a standoff though, because black is not threatening to play f takes g5 due to the pin. So king h2, can I really do this? What if just king g8, escaping the pin? Wait, now knight f3. What's the difference? I guess the difference might be a sacrifice? I'm not sure. Knight f3, knight takes e4, now queen takes a5. Okay, so I just go win that. And the king protects the pawn on g3, so no, knight takes g3 check for black. There is a method to the computer's madness with king h2. When you're playing Blitz, you tend to force things. And e5 is a good example of trying to force things. I was just seeing combinations that weren't there. Black can even just play f takes g5 right here. I thought I was winning the queen after this, but they can just play queen f6, blocking the check. Awful. Will you ever play Simon Williams for Chess Rivals? Hello, Friedrich. Glad you could make a stream. Yes, I will play Simon Williams at some point. How's it going, Captain Morgan? Do you also answer questions on chess.com? You mean if you send me a message? Probably not, because as I said, I don't check my chess.com messages that often. John, what do you think of the Nimzowitsch defense? 2 knight c6 and the Dunst opening, knight c3. I tend not to like them so much, especially knight c3 on move 1 is white. I do think you should avoid openings where the c-pawn gets like unnecessarily blocked. Knight c3 doesn't make as strong of an impression as knight f3, Because with knight f3, you're usually not looking to push the forget about it pawn, the f pawn, anyways. But in many openings, pushing the c pawn to c4 and then getting the knight in behind it is useful. AKA, you know, just one example, the queen's gambit declined. White loves to play the knight in behind the pawn to pressurize d5. So I don't have a strong opinion about knight c3. Or I don't have a positive opinion about it, let's say. Let's play one last game. And huge thanks to the 284 who are watching right now. This will be the final game of the session. Going back in the pool. We can't end on that queen c7 nonsense against Rafa Nadal. Have you ever played the Latvian before? No. What's your opinion on the Stonewall, and would you recommend it to a beginner? The Stonewall is a stodgy variation. If you want to see an example of me playing against the Stonewall recently, I played a one-minute game against one of the kids who came to the camp, the Western Invitational Camp, and that's the last video I posted. It's not a bad line, but I wouldn't recommend it to beginners, no, because I don't think beginners have the positional wherewithal to deal with the structural, the positional weaknesses that are inherent in playing a Stonewall. So when you play it as black, and I can just show this for a second, a game might pop up here, but when you're playing the Stonewall as black, basically you're setting up your pawns like this, all on light squares, and you have dark square weaknesses as a result, specifically the e5 square, and you have to know how to navigate that. Beginners just don't have that sense at all, so I don't think it's a great opening for beginners. What do you play when your opponent plays 3 bishop e7 in the QGD? So you mean this line, d4, d5, c4, e6, knight c3, bishop e7. Often played to stop ideas with bishop g5. I usually go cd, ed, bishop f4, followed by e3, bishop d3, etc. With the dunce, you can transpose into the Vienna game, which is not too bad. True, but if the best you can say about an opening is that it transposes into some other opening, that's probably not a good argument for it. Okay, Super Bass, last opponent. Not getting any higher-rated opponents this session. I'm trying, guys. I'm sorry, but just not happening. Okay, so I'm playing a reverse Grunfeld, it looks like, against Super Bass. We'll see how this turns out. Like, c4 is now the critical move. I think I should play h6 here. There's some theory in this line, but basically you want to prevent the bishop from getting to g5, as far as I remember. Now I think I go here, guarding the c6 pawn. And I believe I should play d4 now. And we'll see what white does. Oh, they can do that. That I didn't see. Take. Does that work, though? So if takes, bishop takes. I'm skeptical as to whether this works for them. I want to risk it. It's the last game of the session. We'll see. If I'm running into some prep or something, we'll find out shortly. Okay, so they just calmly recaptured. Rook c8, maybe? Rook c8 seems logical. I want to get them to do something with that light square bishop. I'm willing to give them the a pawn. I'm not completely attached to that. I know they're going to have 3 pawns, but look how weak those pawns are in an endgame. So they're choosing like a slower type of way of developing. Okay, let's do this. Bishop a3, maybe. They do play it. So I want a castle, but d7 is an issue, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's take. And next I'm going to go queen e7, I think, to try to get out of this. They can play the queen to a4, but maybe then I just take on b5. So this is looking fine. Okay, now I think I can defend. Really? So queen takes, you're going to take on a7 and regain the piece. But what if I just take here? This guy's sacking the house to try to get at my king and prevent me from castling. Now I could just castle if I wanted. Maybe that's the simplest and smartest thing to do. I'm going to do it. Just for simplicity's sake, given the time issue, just castle out of dodge. He might play rook d1. It's a move he could do. Okay, he didn't play that, fortunately. Now I'm going to go win the c4 pawn. and ideally win c3 as well. Okay, let's take that guy. Rook b8, a6, rook here. No. Let's do this. I gotta hustle, though. Bishop f5. Okay, so I'm trying to set up some pawns on light square so I can attack his bishop. Really make his life miserable with that piece. He's playing well, though, and being annoying. Probably need my king up here, so let's do that. Now I think I gotta bring this over. This guy's playing really fast. He's playing pretty well, too, is the other thing. Let's bring this over. So now I'm going to go king to d6, rook to c5, hopefully. Offer a trade. Go here, maybe? Threatening e4 under some circumstances. Okay, let's give it a check. Oh, I'm really low on time now, though. Guess we'll do this. See if he'll take. Oh, so low on time. Just blitzing me out. I want to get e4 or something like that in. It's tough. Keeps kicking me back. Smartly. Keep invading. Okay, now I can get the outside pawn at least. G pawn's pushing. Can swing his rook over. Rook e4, I have king f3. Scandi Swindler one time. So let's take care of that pawn. And next, we're going to go after this pawn. And then we're going to take this. And then we're going to push to victory. And then we're just going to roller mate him. Okay. So I win a time scramble endgame. I had problems in two games as black, though, against lower rated players. Managing my clock. These are the opponents that I have the most trouble with. If you've seen past streams, you know that. These guys who just play objectively bad chess and unsound stuff, but they play very quickly and confidently. And that's what this player did at the outset of the game. I do not believe they ever had compensation. Well, maybe that's harsh. They might have some compensation around here, but I think they have to play it different. Taking on c3 seems too slow, especially if I'm able to go rook c8. Let's take a quick peek at the engine eval, just to confirm. But they put me under pressure, they made me solve problems. In a tournament game, I would love my chances from here, but I had to take time to make sure that I could withstand the pressure and get to a position where I was capable of converting the material. And he just kept throwing bombs. Rook takes d7 here. Yeah, I guess it's probably the only way to go, right? Otherwise, I'm able to castle the safety, most likely, or trade pieces. Okay, so the computer does not like this decision. I just saw that rook d1 was coming to add another attacker to the knight on d7, and I just castled, letting white take. But on second glance, queen d6 does guard the d1 square, so that was probably better. More subtle move. And I actually thought white should play rook d1 right here, and maybe not take on d7 yet. Because if they play rook d1 right now, they can threaten to take and leave the bishop on b5. That way they might hold on to the c4 pawn. That could have been a lot better for them. This endgame is kind of a tough haul, isn't it? He realized that he should just pitch the c-pawn and just focus on his a-pawn. And I had to work some magic with my kingside pawns. I'm sure that white could have played this better. They lost the thread probably around... somewhere around here. They let my king infiltrate. And this is a nice device right here. So they play g4, trying to get me to take If I play f takes g4, I can't play e4 because they have bishop and rook on that. But playing e4, on the other hand, forces them to take with the f pawn, and then it's a misdirection recapture. We take the g pawn, and we've got this outside pass pawn. I'm also seeing now, maybe I should have thought about checking on the c file, but in the heat of the moment, I didn't even consider that. And then after this, black should win. It was just navigating the time. That was a lot of moves in the last 5 seconds, but they were mostly pre-moves. But thank you, BW Golem. I do not. I do not have a coach, Alex. Except for Anton. Which is better, human or machine coach? Almost certainly a human coach. Computers are not at the level yet where they can just be replaced. They can replace humans. I think the benefit you get from an actual person who's made rating strides themselves and know what it takes to get to a certain level is invaluable compared to an engine. An engine just spits out good moves. An engine is what you make of it. But it's never gonna, or at least now, it's not gonna tell you what you should be thinking about in certain positions. It's just gonna give you moves that the engine thinks are best. I think you can get good using an engine. I just think a good human coach is gonna be better. And there are other things that a human can do that a computer is not gonna help you with, like psychological decisions you make at the board, managing your time, things like that. Thank you, head ISB agent. I think that's Alan. Thanks, Alan. It's just natural, Adam. I was born with it. When will you play a standard chess rivals? I asked someone recently to play a standard rivals, and they said they weren't interested in it yet. But I bet I could convince one of the other streamers to do it. I just haven't had much time to do so. John, why are you so white? I can't even see you right now. I'm just kind of a pale person. I actually do get a little bit of a tan going in the summer, but I am pretty white. Can't help you with that, Arab assassin. Okay, let's look at the standings. I think I did better than I probably should have. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So I was 7-1. Should have lost the game to Rafa Nadal, though. So this is like a 6-2 performance. Didn't play this game very well against Mr. Nadal. In this Svechnamer game, I played okay. I just took too long. And my opponent was very tricky. Otherwise, the games before that were pretty good. No complaints. A few Scandies. Always nice. Team Scandi. Are you planning to make more repertoires for Chessable? Yes, I am. I'm making an e4 repertoire for white, and there will be some other ones too. I want to make a Sicilian repertoire for black, and also I have some endgame repertoires in the works. So look out for those in the coming months. And we're also rolling out some improvements to the site too. So that again is something to put on your radar. Thank you, Manuel. John, do you watch Mato Jelic? I do not. Occasionally, if someone posts a link to one of his videos, I'll take a look, but I don't really watch him. He shows a lot of games on his channel, but his analysis of these games is really superficial. I know he doesn't make an attempt really to go in depth, but for learning purposes, I don't really think they're that good, because you can't properly go through like a classic game or a super instructive game in 5 minutes. That's like fast food chess, basically. But he does have a lot of entertaining games on there. And if people just want to see like a sacrificial game very quickly, I think his channel is pretty good. What do you recommend against Bird's opening? So that is f4 on move one. I usually play d5 and just treat it like a reverse Dutch. So you can play almost anything, though, against the birds. I played e5 before the Fromm's Gambit, but I mentioned on a previous stream that someone played e4 in reply, and I was in a King's Gambit, and I didn't know what to do because I hadn't really faced that before from the black side. So I would recommend d5. And then fianchettoing this dark square bishop is a good idea. Get it to g7. John, I'm having problems with the advanced French as black. My opponent always gets the initiative in the middle game. It's kind of a general question. I can't really help you with that. At what time control do you think you could beat Nakamura? I can't beat him at any time control. I might take a game off him here and there, but... I think someone asked about Chessable. So Chessable is basically a way to learn openings in particular. There's an openings focus to the site, and it uses an approach similar to some of these language learning sites, like Duolingo, for instance, using spaced repetition and scheduling. So you can go on and learn from repertoires that users have posted. I posted several myself, and our module will help you learn the openings, help you memorize them and understand them too, if the person has written in notes, as I do in my repertoires. And then you can go back later and review the lines that you've studied. Our system will prompt you to do that, so you can commit your entire repertoire to memory. And we rolled out the site in February. We're trying to make improvements on it. We've got lots of satisfied members. There are many features that we still want to implement. But David's my co-founder, we're working hard on that. And especially in the next couple months, there's going to be some big stuff being rolled out. So go on and take a look. We have free memberships and also paid memberships on there, but even if you opt for a free membership, there's tons of content you can check out for no charge. Why didn't you play in the Dayton Masters? I didn't get invited to the Dayton Masters. I did play last year, but I wasn't in contact with them, and I think they're trying to get some new blood in there as well. That's Dayton, Ohio, if you're wondering. Andrew Tang from Minnesota is playing, so I'm happy about that. I'm going to follow his games. And yes, as Anton said, you can also use Chessable for if you want to upload tactics or endgames. I mentioned that there's an openings focus to the site, but that's not exclusively what we're going for. Whoa, you have a 149-day streak on Chessable? That's impressive, Christoffo. I haven't heard of a streak longer than that. That's a lot. You've basically been streaking since we opened. That's amazing. I do like the word repertoire. Thank you for noticing, Kurt. John, would you do a dual commentary match with I Am Astana? At some point, yeah. He hasn't contacted me or anything. Thing is, there's a lot of guys I would like to play if I had the time. So you'll have to be patient with the dual commentaries. Because when I play a dual commentary, I want to properly advertise it. And the scheduling is always a little tricky. I think they're best to do on the weekend, because then you get the most amount of viewers. You can make it like a afternoon US time, which is an evening in Europe, and most everyone can watch. So it's a little tricky to organize, and people are busy too. Do you make any appreciable amount of money from your YouTube videos? I make some money, but it's nothing substantial, Chris. Have you ever had quadrupled pawns? Not in a tournament game, Anton, but I'm sure in online games I have. No question. Leonardo, it can proceed down some of the variations in the mainline Queen's Gambit declined. You could go for a minority attack. I haven't seen as many games where white will play like f3, e3, knight g2, and try to break in the center. But you can go for a minority attack. There is a line where you play an early g4 in the QGD with bishop e7. Sure thing, Rob. Can you do some general chess interest videos on current games? So coverage of current games, like what's going on in Bilbao. I try to do those from time to time. I do think whenever there's a big tournament going on, there's like such an excess of content to watch, like the official commentary. A lot of YouTubers post analysis videos, so I tend to shy away from that. But if there's a particularly interesting game or two, I do like to go over it. Like, I'm still thinking about going over some games from Bilbao. John, what's your most viewed video? That's a really good question. I don't know. You can check on my page if you click on my videos tab and then sort by views. You can check. Probably one of my bullet videos, I'm guessing, because I had a bullet video as like my channel trailer for a while. That was the first video that people see when they navigate to my channel. And that one racked up like at least 60,000 views or something. Some of the Play Magnus videos might be popular, the Chess Fundamentals videos. Yeah, I thought about that, Priya, doing commentary on a big tournament or the World Championship. I gotta see what my plans are for the World Championship. If it's actually in New York, which somehow seems doubtful at the moment, because they haven't announced the site or anything. If it's in New York, I'll probably be at the World Championship. I'm gonna make a trip out there. But if not, I'm sure I'll be covering it in some capacity on my channel. All right, I gotta run, guys. So thank you for tuning into the stream. We went about an hour and a half. Really appreciate you guys watching as always. And I'm home for the next couple weeks, so I'll probably do a few more streams here and there. And sorry I wasn't able to answer everyone's question. But not bad. At least we did better than the last stream. I won more than one game, so I will take that. All right, everyone. Have a good evening or day wherever you're at. And I will see you guys again soon with more videos. Talk to you guys later. Bye.